Hallelujah. Ooh. God is good, church. He is good all the time. Amen. I said that God is good, church. Amen. I don't know what he's done for you other than I see you all here right now. But God is good, church. Amen. Whew. Y'all, I just come just to, you know, give like a few reminders that God is good, right? Amen. You know, sometimes we have to be reminded of some things, okay? But I'm going to share, whoo, Lord Jesus, just have your way in this house, Lord. Whoo, okay. So in June, most of you all knew that I had to have surgery, right? So a week prior to my surgery, my doctor was like, I need you to come in for ultrasound. So I was like, oh, okay. So I come in for the ultrasound, and she was like, hey, we found some tumors on you, right? So I was like, oh, okay. So in my mind, I was like, girl, don't panic. That ain't what we doing. We trust in God, amen? So my doctor turns around to me, and she says, we have to send the tumors off to the lab for them to test to see if it's cancerous. But what she said when she turned around and looked at me, she said, but I'm confident that it's not going to be no cancer, right? So I was like, okay, girl, I'm confident too, amen? You know, when you have somebody else that's confident with you, that does something to your faith, amen? So the day before my surgery, they called me and they're like, hey, we need you to be there at 7. So I'm like, okay. You know, I'm the only morning person in my household. Let me just put that out. I'm the morning person, the jolly person in the morning. So we get there, and it's like, I think we got there like at 6, something at 6 or something like that. And they called me back, and I was like, wow, they calling me back early. And she said, well, the person that was scheduled to have their surgery before you, they didn't show. So we're going to go and get you started. So I was like, oh, God, okay, praise Jesus. Okay. So I'm in the back, and most of you all know, I don't like needles. That's one thing I don't like. I'm not going to say I'm scared of them. I just don't like them. So I told the girl that came in, I was like, look, if you don't think you can stick me one time, get somebody that's faithful that believe they can. Because I don't want to have to go off, because I don't like to be stuck more than one time. So she was like, well, I'm confident. And I was like, ooh, that word again, God, confident, okay? So she was like, she got me prepped, got my IV in. I was like, girl, you did that. God is good. Yes, he is. So they are taking me back, and she was like, do you want to hear some music? And I was like, yeah, I want to hear some music in the room. She said, what kind of music do you want to hear? And I was like, girl, play me some gospel music, because that's what I need. She said, okay, we got you. We got you, y'all. She was letting me, she got me, amen. So I go in there, and the song that's on the radio is Gyra. More Than Enough, you know, the song Gyra. And I'm singing my little heart out. Y'all can't tell me I didn't sound good. Y'all, I was singing my heart out. And I'm going to call the nurses, let's say Rebecca and Linda. And I hear them over there, Gyra, you are. And I said, oh, I know they ain't trying to out-sing me. So I'm already got the medicine in me, y'all, and I got super loud. And I'm Gyra. I was like, ooh, Lord, I'm Whitney Houston, little sister. They can't tell me I don't sound good. So then, next thing I know, it's a man waking me up saying, Miss Walker, I need you to slide onto this bed. And I'm like, huh? He was like, I need you to slide onto this bed. And I was like, no, I'm here for surgery. He was like, we already done the surgery. So I was like, ooh, that was fast. Because I'm like, I was just singing the song Gyra with the backup singers. You know, we was getting down in the operating room. So I'm like, okay, you need me slide over. I heard him, but my brain was not registering, so I went back to sleep. Miss Walker, I need you to slide over to this bed. I said, okay. I went back to sleep. Miss Walker, I need you to slide over to this bed, please. When I tell you that man had patience, because I was like, oh, I went back to sleep. Y'all, they gave some good medicine. I went right back to sleep. And he was like, Miss Walker, I really need you to slide onto this bed so we can take the other bed out of here. And y'all, I know I had an attitude. I don't know what all I said, but I was like, ooh. So I slid over, right? Slid over to the bed, and he said, thank you, ma'am. Have a great day. And I was like, oh, Thank you. Okay. So I'm going through all of this stuff and I'm like, Lord, oh my God, I'm in pain. But God, I know you a healer. Because I know what you've done for me in the past. Amen. How many know that God has done something for you? Remember, right? Put some on your mind, right? I was like, okay, you brought me through back surgery. All right, God, I know this is you. You got this. You know, this is bigger than me, but it ain't bigger than you, right? So my doctor comes to see me, and she was like, I told you what we were going to do and all that. We sent the stuff to the lab. I need you to come see me in a week. We saw 3 tumors, but we don't know until it goes to the lab. So I was like, oh, okay. Y'all, I'm in and out. Like, just knocked out in and out. So the next week, my mama take me. Shout out for mama. Whoop, whoop, yes. My mama took me to my appointment because I couldn't drive. I went clear to drive. My husband went back to work. So we get there, and she's like, how are you feeling? And I was like, I mean, I'm a little uncomfortable, but I can push through, you know. And she was like, well, I just want you to know that the lab results came back that you had several tumors. They couldn't count them all, but there was no cancer. Oh, yes! Y'all, it wasn't no cancer. I was like, oh my God, my confidence in my God. You know, and then I had confidence in my doctor, her words that she spoke in my life. Then my bishop was praying, my mama was praying, my husband was praying, my kids was praying, my church was praying, amen. Y'all, I just stand to tell y'all, just remind y'all that God's grace is sufficient. He's always there. He shows up on time. Y'all, if I cry, it's tears of joy. I ain't no punk, but if I cry, it's tears of joy, amen. But God is so good, y'all, because he brought me through last time. Yeah. And he brought me through this time. Amen. My God, when I tell you my steps are ordered by God, your steps are ordered by God. If you believe and just trust him, my God. Yeah. Y'all, she said, no cancer. And I was like, oh, Lord, praise God. I thank you for this report. And while I was in there, you know, they have those little real thin walls. And I hear this lady in the next room, and she's like, oh, my God, I just can't stop crying. She said the lady couldn't find a heartbeat. She's saying all this stuff, and I went in prayer mode. I'm in pain. Just had surgery a week ago. I went in prayer mode. Lord, in the name of Jesus, God, comfort her. You know, I'm praying for her. I don't know this lady. I don't know what she's looking like. I don't know anything about her other than she was crying out to our doctor. And I heard my doctor say, I'm confident. I was like, oh, Jesus. She confident that just because you have spotting or anything like that, that does not mean it's over. Amen. Right. Woo. But I'm praying and trusting God that all is well with that lady to this day. Amen. Amen. Woo. So I go back to see her, and I'm walking, and she was like, oh, well, you look like you're doing amazing. I was like, girl, that's God. God did that. Because I was listening to other people's stories about what they went through and all that, and I was like, no, we ain't finna, no. But y'all, God is good, okay? He's good. His grace is sufficient. God's grace is amazing, church. Amen? Woo! Lord have mercy. God is great. But yeah, I told y'all I thought I was a lead singer with the group with Rebecca and Linda. Baby, y'all can tell us nothing. They should have recorded us because we was jamming. Amen? Woo! So my first scripture is Isaiah 43:2. It says, when you go through the waters, I am with you. Amen. And through the rivers will not overflow you. When you walk through the fire, thou shalt not be burned, neither shall the flame kindle upon you. I don't know about y'all, but that's encouraging to me. Yes. So let me know if anything come, God is with me and I can overcome it with God's help. Amen. Amen. Not in my own strength. Not in my own strength, but through God. Amen? Because your steps are ordered by God. Amen? And what we need to do, church, is trust God. Don't put your trust and faith in what you see. Because God sees everything and he knows. Amen? Woo! All right, Lord. Amen. It's a little hot up in here, but God is great. Amen. So next scripture is 2 Corinthians 12:7-10. And it says, and lest I should be exalted above measure, through the abundance of the revelations, there was gifted. He was given something he didn't ask for. We're talking about Paul. to me a thorn in the flesh. The messenger of Satan to buffet me, and buffet means to hit something or someone repeatedly with great force. Amen. Lest I should be exalted above measure. For this thing I besought the Lord thrice, that it might depart from me. And he said unto me, my grace, the undeserved favor is sufficient. It's enough. The right amount, y'all, is the right amount, church. For thee, for my strength is made perfect in weakness. Most gladly, therefore, will I rather glory in my infirmities, that the power of Christ may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in necessities, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, have you ever been weak? Had a weak moment? Then am I strong, amen? Then I am strong. But in this, when I was doing my study, and I was like, Paul said, Lord, take this from me. Have y'all ever wanted the Lord to take something from you? Because it was too heavy or too hard for you to bear. And then you still got what you asked him to take from you. My God, my God. His grace is sufficient, church. It's sufficient. And when I heard that about his grace is sufficient, it means that God, he gives you just the amount that you need. He don't give you not enough. He don't give you too much. He give you the right amount. So one of my examples is this. Now, I know it's some bakers in the house that do stuff from scratch. I'm not one. So this is a box of some muffins. So when you look at this, it has instructions, specific instructions for you, right? It tells you how much water you need, oil, and eggs. But what if I doubled the ingredients that it said? It'll be a sloppy mess. On here, it said 2 eggs. It don't say, Kamika, girl, go add 6 eggs to it. It don't say, put 3 cups of oil in it, say 1/3. It's specific. So if you making a cake and you doing what the box say, because some of y'all may be them people that do this stuff from scratch. I know a few of y'all. But like I said, I'm not one of them, amen? Amen. So follow the instructions, because you're given specific instructions. It's just like if you're a driver and you have a car, and you driving and just driving and just driving. At some point, you got to go to the gas station, amen? You got to go put gas in your car, okay? I seen this video a while ago where this girl was pranking her husband and said that she put the Christmas oil in her car. And he was like, what is Christmas oil? She said, you know, the green oil. And he went off on her so bad because that's diesel, right? She called it Christmas oil because she thought it was Christmas oil because it was a green handle. But y'all, it ain't Christmas oil, okay? It's diesel. Don't do that, all right? But in order for you to keep driving, you have to stop and put gas in your car. It's the same with that. You're not going to put too much gas in your car or it's going to leak out on you and you're going to stink, okay? But, and then you can put like a lid in there and still be able to go. But when you fill your car up, you can go real far, amen? Amen. Yes, amen. Ain't that right? So this thorn in the flesh said to be a messenger of Satan, which he sent for evil, but God designed it and overruled it for good, y'all. Ain't it a blessing to know and trust that God has the last say so? Whoo, my God. It says, when we are afflicted with thorns in the flesh, we should give ourselves to prayer. If an answer be not given to the first prayer nor the second prayer, we are to continue to pray. Continue and pray. 1 Thessalonians reminds us to pray without ceasing. That's 5:17. It tells us to pray without ceasing, meaning never to stop praying. We are to always pray. Amen. Troubles are sent to teach us to pray and to be continued to teach us to continue instant and pray. Amen. So grace simplifies the good will of God towards us. And that is enough to enlighten and enliven us, sufficient to strengthen us and comfort us in all afflictions and distresses. Y'all, have you just ever had a moment where you like, Lord, I want to throw in the towel? I don't know about y'all, I have. I ain't going to look at y'all, but I know I have. Like, I want to throw in, Lord, this is too much. I can't handle all this. Lord, I need some of this taken away from me, okay? Because it's only one me. You know, yes, amen. In that moment where you feel like you need a clone or somebody else that can help do half of the stuff you do, but God said his grace is sufficient. He got you, okay? You can do all things through Christ who strengthens you. His strength is made perfect in our weakness. When we are weak in ourselves, then we are strong in the grace our Lord Jesus Christ, y'all, that he gives us. When we feel that we are weak in ourselves, then we can go to Christ and receive the strength from him. Amen. Y'all, you have to do something in order to get it. You got to ask, Lord, I know that you are the grace giver. Your word says that your grace is sufficient for me. Lord, I need you. I need help. I'm weak, Lord, but you are strong and mighty. I know that this battle does not belong to me. It's yours, God. I know you're working behind the scenes. I trust you, Lord, because I know that you can do it. Y'all, remind him of what his words say. Right. Ain't nothing wrong with that. But then I was doing my study, and I was studying, thinking about Moses and the manna in Exodus 16, where Moses is like, hey, take what you need today. Take what you need today. Don't get none for later. Take what you need today. And then the word says that some of the people, they took more than what they needed for today. Oh, Lord, they said, we're going to stock some. We're going to stock it. So then they come to find out that what they stocked, the manna that God rained from heaven, amen? They stocked it. Then they looked at it. It was molded. Worms came. And it stunk. The word said it stunk, church. Yeah. And I'm like, and then Moses said, it said in the word that Moses got upset with the people. Yo, he will give you exactly what you need when you need it. You know, they were trying to, let us just get all this stuff, get all this. They'll get their own. We're going to get us some. Get you some for Bobo. Get you some for Lily. Get you some. Get some more, because we may need some later. Get some more. God said, get what you need today. Tomorrow brings other stuff and strong stuff, more grace, amen. Get what you need today. Oh, Lord. Them children, y'all, my spiritual imagination, I can see them just, they just getting it all. Lord have mercy, getting it all. Whew. But I'm sorry about the mic. I know God is a God of enough, amen. Whew. Okay, 2 Corinthians 12:9, the Amplified Version says, but he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, right? My loving kindness and my mercy are more than enough, always available, regardless of the situation. For my power is being perfected and is completed and shows itself most effectively in your weakness. Therefore, I will all the more gladly boast in my weaknesses so that the power of Christ may completely enfold me and may dwell in me. My God, y'all, his grace is sufficient, amen? It's more than enough. It's the right amount that you need, amen? All right, so the same verse, because I like to do different versions, the Message Bible. It says, because of the extravagance of those revelations, and so I wouldn't get a big head. Lord, have you ever had a big head? I ain't looking. I don't know. Have you ever got the big head? I was given the gift of a handicap to keep me in constant touch with my limitations. Satan's angel did his best to get me down. What he in fact did was push me to my knees. Amen. He thought he was doing so bad, but he pushed you to your knees, made you remember what you've been taught. Amen, church? No danger. Then of walking around high and mighty. At first, I didn't think of it as a gift and begged God to remove it. Three times I did that, three. And then he told me, my grace is enough. It's all you need. My strength comes into its own in your weakness. Once I heard that, I was glad to let it happen. I quit focusing on the handicap and began appreciating the gift. It was a case of Christ's strength moving in on my weakness. Now I take limitations in stride and with good cheer. These limitations that cut me down to size, abuse, accidents, opposition, bad breaks. I just let Christ take over. And so the weaker I get, oh my God, the weaker I get, the stronger I become, amen? So every single day I remind myself to trust in God, not my circumstances, because I know that God is bigger. I know God is bigger than whatever may come my way. Yes, obstacles come. You know, we, in our mind, we think our path's supposed to be like this. You know, when you're walking with the Lord, but your path be like, your path be all over the place, amen? You never know, but you have to trust that God know what he is doing, y'all, because he do. You just don't, okay? Anywho, Proverbs 3, 5, and 6, the Amplified Version says, trust in and rely confidently on the Lord with all your heart, not 10%, not 75%, not even 99%. It said all, amen? All your heart, and do not rely on your own insight or understanding. In all your ways, not a few, not a little bit. It says, in all your ways, know and acknowledge and recognize him, and he will make your path straight and smooth, removing obstacles that block your way. Oh, Lord, y'all ever been trying to do something and someone was blocking you and you couldn't go? Oh, Lord, in the name of Jesus, amen. Oh, y'all, he is hot up in here, God. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Remember, the same God that made a way last time will make a way this time and the next time and the next time and the next time and the next time. Trust him because he's everything we need. Amen? All right. So I'm going to tell you about a few people that God showed grace in the Bible. So God's grace infuses Noah's story. And this is Genesis 6, 8. But Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. We know the story about God, where he regretted that he made human people because of what all they was doing. But Noah, hello, Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Wickedness and evil were so rampant in the hearts of men that God actually regretted creating them. He was ready to wipe them all out entirely, but there was one man. Somebody say one man. All right, one man who was righteous, faithful, and committed to walking with God. Noah was not a perfect man, yet God chose to save his family from destruction. That's grace, church. It says God chose. He made a decision. Oh, all these folks doing all that, but oh, Noah. Noah got my grace. He's not a perfect man, but I feel he's going to be obedient and do what I need him to do. And Noah did do that, amen? He built that big boat, that ark. Yes, he did. All right, so another person is God's grace endures in spite of Abraham and Sarah's unbelief. And in Genesis 12:3, it says, and in you all the families of the earth shall be blessed. Okay, so you remember the part in the story where Abraham was lying, saying Sarah was his sister to save his own self, right? And you also know Sarah laughed at God when he told her she was going to give birth to a son in her old age. Child. Y'all, she laughed at God. Sarah 90. And like, Lord, who finna have a child? Who you say? Lord, I know you ain't talking about me and Abe. Ooh, child, you 100. Not us. But God knew these things, right? Like, no, Lord, my husband ain't Abe. I'm Sarah. You know how old I'm is, right? I know that's Ebony's Auntie Gail back there. You know how old I am. You know my joints hurt and everything. Who finna give birth? Y'all, she had the nerve to laugh at God. But we were taught that nothing is too big for God. Ain't that right, church? If God said it was gonna happen, it was gonna happen, amen. Even in her laughter, y'all, my spiritual imagination, like, Lord, who you talking to? You know my name, Sarah. This ain't the other girl across the street. This my name, Sarah. And you know my husband, my man named Abe. She, like, reminded God, like, no, I know who I'm talking about, child. Sarah and Abraham. But God showed grace. And it happened, amen? It happened. All right, another person is God's grace for Joseph gave him strength to persevere. Y'all know what Joseph went through? His brother sold him and did all this stuff. Y'all, they hated him. Whew, it's bad when your siblings hate you. My God, they hated him. He had a coat of many colors, y'all. And they like, daddy giving him a coat. Well, our coat is. You know, it's them haters. And it's bad when it's your family. But that's another story, okay? Ain't nobody in here. But anywho. So then his dad tells him to go take his brothers. So some food. I want to say there was in Dothan, but I'm going by memory. He took them that, thank you, Bishop, took them the food, and they was like, here go this dreamer. You know, folks see you come and be like, oh, Lord, here come Miss Holy. You know, they talk about you when you come, and some of them don't like to see you coming, amen? It's just the guy's honest truth. So he gets there, and they plotted to kill him. And Reuben, big brother Reuben, came and was like, no, let's not kill him. Let's just throw him in this pit, you know? So Reuben, they throw him in the pit. Reuben go about his business, come back. He was like, what a lad it. Well, brother, y'all know we can't go to dad and we ain't got this boy with us. He the favorite. My God, what we gonna do? So they plotted this story, killed this animal and put blood on his jacket, right? Took it to his dad and said, oh Lord, a great beast devoured your favorite child. So it was a sad moment, amen? So he went through a whole lot of stuff with his boss wife, was trying to get him because it say that he was a handsome man. Say he was handsome, y'all. So he ran and he done all these things. He ended up going to jail. He interpreted some stories. But what I like about this story is that when he saw his brothers coming, he recognized them. They didn't recognize who Joseph was. And I love the fact how God hid his identity where they couldn't see that it was their brother that they did all that to 17 years ago, okay? All right, so it says, as Joseph's story unfolds, it's difficult to see God's grace in it. Despised by his brothers, your bros, sold into slavery, wrongly accused, left to rot in prison. But that's not at all how Joseph saw things. Somebody say perspective. You know, he had to see it in a different way because he was like, I know God got a plan. I don't know what he's doing, but I know he got to have a plan as to why I'm going through all this. So he reveals his perspective in Genesis 45 and 7. He says to his brothers, but God sent me ahead of you to preserve for you a remnant on earth and to save your lives by a great deliverance. God used a difficult and trying circumstance to position Joseph as the savior of his people. That's grace. You know, God put you in a place. It's for a reason. You may not know why, but understanding, I promise, will come later. But Joseph, it says if you read the whole story that he wept, he cried, because he was happy to see his brothers, even though they did him wrong. Oh, Lord, now that's God's grace right there, for you can cry and hug on somebody and they done you wrong. Oh, Lord, because some people may want to beat somebody up. I know it ain't nobody in here, but I'm just saying, like, they be wanting to knock folks out because you done did me wrong. I remember what you did them 20 years ago, and now I see you. This is my time to get revenge. That ain't God's way, church. Don't do that. That ain't right, okay? That ain't right. That ain't what I'm saying. Don't do that, okay? Amen. So the next person is Rahab. She bravely asked God to save her life in spite of her past sins, and he did. Y'all know about Rahab? I'm going to tell you about them. Anyway, so it says, the Lord your God is God in heaven above and on the earth below. That's Joshua 2:11. So Rahab is referred to as a harlot 3 times over in scripture. She was a prostitute. She was a sinner, unworthy of God's grace. Somebody looking at her like, girl, I know you ain't asking the Lord for nothing with everything you done. All of us got a past. Hello? Nobody is perfect. No sin is bigger and better and worse than the other one. Sin is wrong. Amen? But somewhere along the way, she heard tales of this God of Israel. Y'all, somebody was talking. Y'all, that's why it's important. Y'all be talking. Y'all don't know who's listening to y'all. Y'all talk about God as much as you can because you don't know who's listening. They may not come up to you and be like, oh, I heard what you said. But listen, they may be listening. You don't know. So she said she heard tales of this God of Israel. So when the 2 spies sought shelter in her home, she bravely bargained for her life. She confessed her belief in their God and asked for their mercy, and they gave it willingly to her and all of her family. In fact, she dwelled with the Israelites and faithfully served God the rest of her days. Y'all, this grace. My God, change this lady. She used to be a prostitute. But God said, that ain't the end of your story. Hello, God's grace. He did that. He can do that for you too. He can do that for me. He can do that for all of us. Oh, Lord, the last person, y'all, brother David. Ooh. David lusted, stole, fornicated, lied, and killed. Yet God still used him because he looked at his heart and he loved him. In Psalms 51:1, it says, "Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity and cleanse me from my sin." David knew he was doing wrong. He knew. It says David is the ultimate example of God's unmerited favor. But I've got to start by mentioning all of his merits, y'all. Woo, because there are so many. Just open up the book. If you open up the book of Psalms, you can read a lot, okay? It says, in his heart of hearts, David, he even strayed from his love of God. He just made some pretty terrible decisions along the way. Haven't we all made some bad decisions that we hate we did? Right. The key is to always turn from sin and repent. Repent and God forgave. That's grace. Amen. God shows each and every one of us grace. Because we make mistakes. Ain't y'all grateful for God's grace? Yeah. I know I am. But you can always repent and make things right with God. Amen. Because his grace is a mighty gift. His grace is sufficient, church. And it's the amount that you need. Not too little, not too much. It's the right amount. Amen. So I just want to encourage you that's on this race called life, remember to keep running. Just keep going, okay? Because you know the Christian life is like a relay race where you're running. I bet you I thought I was going to run. I ain't going to. But anyway, so you're doing this relay race and you're running. Things coming in your life, you got to dodge stuff. But you can't stop. Keep running. Because we know David said, though I walk through, he ain't say I sit down. He ain't say I took a nap. He ain't say I talked to Bobo and Lulu. He said, I walk through the shadow. I walk through. Church, that don't mean that you just chill and take a break. Don't give up. Don't stop. Amen. And on this walk, God put people in our lives for a reason. But listen to him when he tells you to encourage and witness to them. Amen. Tell what God has done for you. Amen. So again, as I take my seat, ooh, amen. I thank God for the on-time spirit in the house. Praise the Lord, y'all. Listen, God's grace is sufficient for you. It's the right amount that you need, Brother Chick. Brother Isaiah, I'm sorry. Brother Isaiah, it's the right amount of grace that you need. Sister Valerie, it's the right amount that you need. Victoria, it's the right amount that you need. Sister Mary, Sister Gladys, everybody in here, Bishop, it's the right amount that you need. You can't be like, Lord, you ain't give me enough. Yes, he did. Yes, he did. He gave you the right amount that you needed right then. Don't be like those Israelites. No. Take what you need today. And God can provide because he's Jehovah Jireh. We know him as a provider. Amen. Whew. Be blessed, church. God's grace is sufficient. It's enough for you and it's enough for me. Praise the Lord. I'm going to take my seat and turn it over here to Bishop. Amen. Praise Jesus, Bishop. You said I'm not finished. Oh, amen. Praise Jesus. Ooh, Lord. Praise him. His grace.